Hello and welcome to the hard sell where the stick in the feeding trough rattles back. Today I'm outstanding in this field, fuck you, because movie song can't make cows, and today's episode is about butter and margarine. Butter is one of those basic foodstuffs that have been a staple for thousands of years now. Although back in antiquity, the super civilized likes of the Romans and Greeks tended to look down on the dumbass barbarians who used to eat it. Well, fuck them, because it's delicious. Ironically, margarine, the popular alternative made from vegetable fat and oil, was invented for the exact same reason in reverse, as by the 19th century, butter was considered far too good for the plebs, as well as prohibitively fiddly to supply to a constantly marching army. Butter as a dairy product came under the marketing auspices of the Butter Council, with funds from the Milk Marketing Board, and so we got plenty of what I call stuff adverts for the generic concept, the platonic ideal of butter. You might remember the extremely poncy campaign from 1989 or so that I showed you in an earlier episode. Well, that's very much the pretentious art Christ end of the 80s. Over at the other end, we got terrifying stop-motion constructions with northern-accented slices of bread talking in a disturbing, faintly sexualized way about their love of butter, before breaking into an increasingly threatening chant, like the National Union of Just About Everything in the Kitchen.
Ooh, I hope it's butter today, not anything else.
Bread and butter. It's traditional, ain't it? Oh, that taste makes me feel all mouth-watering and crumbly.
Aye, lad. No buts, it's got to be butter. 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 No buts, it's...
Butter? But of course.
I leave you to decide which approach is worse, if it's not a no-score draw.
No buts, it's got to be butter.
Anyway, all of that is just by way of urging you to use the stuff in general. It gives you no help in deciding what brand to buy, which is obviously the important thing. It's also quite confusing when it comes to dairy products. Well, anything you get from a farm, actually. Because obviously farms were once generally run by a single landowner. And to the extent brands even existed as we understand them today, they were basically just the name of the farm. As time went on, the world got smaller, money talked louder, and dairies started to pool their resources, merging together into local guilds, then regional companies, and then national ones. And after the 30s, behind them all was the Milk Marketing Board, who controlled the base value of the white stuff by acting as a buyer of last resort, and also, as the name suggests, promoting the dairy industry with adverts like those ones we just saw. The biggest British butter brand, arguably, has usually been Country Life. This was launched when the Milk Marketing Board decided to create a few brands of its own, and spun off the English Butter Consortium as an all-new company for the purpose. It was a success, largely because of the advertising. Commercial animation house Wyatt Catania were hired, who specialised in creating lovable squiggle vision mascots who were marketable in themselves. They were behind the Tetley Tea Folk, the KP Friars, and Fred the Flower Grader, for whose sake it was that Wyatt and Catania themselves left Richard Williams Studios to set up on their own. Could they work their magic one more time? Yes, of course they could and did.
Oh, we are the lads from Country Life, and you'll never put a better bit of butter on your knife. If you haven't any aim, have a word with your wife and spread it on your toast in the morning. It's Country Life, it's English too for...
Who's this?
Dunno.
What are they doing?
Dunno.
Where'd he going?
Oh, bye.
Oh, bye.
Bye.
Bye. So spread it on your toast in the morning.
Country life. You'll never put a better bit of butter on your knife.
Dripping Yellow Madness, I mean the Buttermen, didn't quite make it to the level of the Smash Robots, Busby or Cresta Bear in having their own spin-off picture books, but they were on tea towels and pin badges, which isn't to be sneezed at. They weren't as irritating as Busby or the Robots either, although of course they were nowhere near as cool as Cresta Bear, but that's just to be expected. They lasted throughout the 80s and even had their copyrights renewed in 1991, but by then the industry was poised for deregulation and fragmentation and the Country Life brand was thrown to the wind. It eventually landed in the lap of Dairy Crest, which used to be the main brand of the Milk Marketing Board, and thus is the cycle of life completed. As such, it's still around today and still quite popular, although it was only Britain's biggest selling butter for a brief period when the brand spokesman was John Lydon.
Do I buy Country Life butter because it's British?
Do I buy Country Life because I yearn for the British countryside?
Or because it's made only from British milk? Nah, I buy Country Life because I think it tastes the best.
It's not about Great Britain, it's about great butter.
Yes, of course he sold out. Everyone sells out. The only possible means of avoiding selling out was discovered by Sid Vicious, and for obvious reasons it's not all that popular. As for the Buttermen, well, they were actually brought back a few years ago, but no one noticed. Anchor were always there or thereabouts as well, and they're also a British brand. Sort of. In a not actually British kind of way, because they're from New Zealand. But the Anchor butter you buy in British shops comes from British cows eating British grass, and the UK branch has sufficient autonomy that they're practically a separate company as it is. At least that's what they say. Their biggest success began in the late 80s when they started their iconic Singing Cows campaign.
So good. Others bread would taste like Anchor too if they could. They may try to imitate us as you can see. When we are Anchor cows and do it naturally. Moo moo moo. Moo 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 moo. Moo 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 moo. We're the Anchor cows and make a butter so good. Others bread would taste like Anchor too if they could. They may try to imitate us as you can see. But we are Anchor cows and do it naturally.
Highlighting the natural side of the product, and the fact that it comes from free-range grass-fed cows, with the help of lots of CSO and especially video editing trickery, creating bovine Busby Berkeley parades that were extremely fresh at the time. No, really. Compare it to a typical Anchor advert before they came up with this idea.
To anchor for the real taste of butter.
You see, so in 1987, digitally manipulated cows were interesting and new.
Excuse me butting in, but I thought I heard you mutter that there's nothing richer tasting than the taste of Anchor butter.
No, there's nothing richer tasting than the taste of Anchor butter.
The reason's right here, a growing out the ground, is this green, green grass that grows all year round.
The reason's right here, a growing out the ground, it's this green, green grass that grows all year round.
Why, right through the winter, you'd find it'd last you, which is why Anchor cows can always eat pasture. Oh, yeah.
Which is why Anchor cows can always eat pasture. That rich, creamy taste, there's no way you can mistake it, even though other brands try their best to imitate it.
When you've tried Anchor butter, there's no richer to be found. Cause only Anchor cows eat grass all the year round.
Man. So obviously over the next decade or two, they ran it right into the ground. By the turn of the century, they were blessedly allowing the cows to be cows again.
Steamed grass. Grilled grass. Grass soup. A lightly tossed grass salad. Anchor believe butter tastes better when cows are fed on green grass all year round. Anchor spreadable. It's in our nature.
In fact, they ended up going a bit far in the other direction, because by 2012, they were depicting the entire company as being literally staffed by cows. Except the lorry driver, presumably because you need hands instead of hooves to operate the steering wheel. I bet he makes three times as much as them as well. Usually the biggest selling butter other than own brands in this country is Steve Lerpak, an upstart from Denmark. And they of course have their own iconic butterman, a soloist called Douglas, cast in plasticine by Aardman, rather than wobbly 2D white Catania animation. He's most famous for wandering about on a tablecloth trying to play the trombone and being told off by Penelope Keith, which he was doing throughout the 90s.
Some things are worth paying a little more for, like Lerpak butter. Made from a delicious blend of the finest creams, only Lerpak has that fresh, smooth, sophisticated... I said sophisticated. You'll get it back after the commercial, Douglas. Oh, oh, pure creamy Lerpak. It's a matter of taste.
But a decade before that, his shtick was singing popular songs from the 50s, because that's when his writers were kids, rewritten to be about how great Lerpak was.
Lerpak's taste is delicate, and here's why that is true. Lerpak's not a yellow butter, it's a lighter hue. If you ain't tried it, you better join the queue. Use your loaf, go and spread. Some Lerpak taste, lighten up, go and spread. Some Lerpak taste.
Douglas's brags about creaminess, and the perhaps slightly odder one about not being yellow, preemptively turns the tables on Anchor. Their big cow-related selling point, that the milk comes from grass-eating, free-range cow ladies, is actually shared by most British brands of butter. It's what makes it yellow. Most of our dairy cows are grass-fed. We have an abundance of it. Right through the winter you'd find it at last year, which is why British cows can always eat pasture. Grass is high in beta-carotene. Corn and other such grains that make up artificial fodder are not. And the butter from such sources is white and oily, or as Lerpak spin it, creamy instead. Your corn-fed cow will produce more milk, but it won't be as rich as grass-fed milk. You pay your money and you take your choice. That's enough of the real stuff. What if we're already too fat for angel butter? Well, then you turn to margarine, don't you? As invented at the behest of Emperor Napoleon III by some bloke called Hippolyte Mesmurier, although apparently the similarity of the name is a coincidence. The biggest name in actual proper marge in this country is probably Flora. They're not the most interesting brand on earth, of course, and most of their advertising has been pretty Route 1. But they did have an interesting spin in the late 70s and early 80s, however.
Like many men today, he's a Flora man. He's asking for Flora margarine, with the taste men like. That light, delicate taste that comes from Flora's pure sunflower oil. More and more men are getting a taste for Flora. And more Flora wives are getting the message. Flora. Flora, the margarine for men.
So much going on here. Naturally, say it with me, you couldn't make this today. In more ways than one. Because this is quite jaw-droppingly sexist in a way and to an extent that it actually wouldn't make sense in today's world. At least you'd hope not. Not only is it nonchalantly accepted as the woman's job to do the shopping, it's considered such an inherently feminine task that the men daren't even set foot in the shop itself, despite having to inconvenience themselves as a result. Surely no one under the age of about 60 could truly relate to an impulse like that. And then there's the basic concept of Flora as the margarine for men, which trades on societal assumptions about masculinity and femininity that Barbara Ellen could probably write a book about if she wanted. And that was Flora's tagline for years.
Every evening after work, you'll find them tending their land. The lost in the jungle man, the I go by the book man, we've been growing them for years, man. And the Flora man. Because wherever you go in Britain today, you find more men becoming Flora men. Their wives know they like that light, delicate taste. Flora is made with pure sunflower oil, so it's high in polyunsaturates. Is there a Flora man in your home? Flora, the margarine for men.
Now that's what I call man spread. Oh, shut up. Thing is, these ads are still aimed at women, because it's still 1981, and so they're the ones doing the shopping. It might be the margarine for men, but us XY types aren't expected to do anything about it for ourselves. That would mean entering a shop that isn't an off-licence.
Some time ago, Sarah Drake decided to change her husband. More and more women are coming to the same decision.
Hi there.
They're changing their husbands to Flora men, because men like Flora's light, delicate taste. Flora is made with pure sunflower oil, so it's high in polyunsaturates.
Oh, no.
Is it time to change your husband? Flora, the margarine for men.
Our wives are encouraged to buy it for us to make us better, and arguably for their sake more than our own. It's like Stepford husbandry. Except that it's only margarine and therefore doesn't actually do anything.
Flora, the margarine for men.
But what if you could trick him into not realising it was margarine? The first butter-imitating spreads came along in the early 80s, led by the original I Can't Believe It's Not Butter, first invented in 1979. It didn't get here to the UK until 1991, however, and in the interim, other companies reverse-engineered the formula and brought out their own versions. The first and biggest in this country was St. Ivel Gold from Unigate. They were one of, and at one point the, biggest dairy companies around, the final megazord formed out of Cowangate and United Dairies. Hence Unigate, get it? They also owned the St. Ivel brand from way back when one of their constituent parts was Aplin and Barrett of Yeovil, Ivel being another name for Yeovil. Aplin and Barrett were long forgotten by now, early pieces in the giant catamaran that was Unigate, but the brand was strong enough to become their public face for everything dairy-based that wasn't actual milk, including their butter-like spread.
Follow me, dearios. Here's a milking ballad to encourage cows to give thee buttermilk and butter oil, which when blended with vegetable oil makes delicious St. Ival gold. If I say it's for St. Ival, I do hope you understands. Will you look upon me kindly and obliging fill these cans? Yes, I will, on one condition. Will you kindly warm your hands?
Low-fat St. Ival gold, the best thing from the dairy since butter.
Williams in excelsis there, both Kenneth and Richard. For some reason, though, a couple of years later, they'd swapped rambling Sid Rumpo for a series of highly mannered, faintly menacing formalist tableaux, narrated by the forbidding Michael Jackson.
St. Ival Gold is unique. It contains half the fat of any margarine. Yet it's made in a dairy, with vegetable oil and real buttermilk, for a buttery taste, with half the fat. Gold, from St. Ival.
Maybe they were trying to intimidate you into buying the stuff. There's nothing you can do to prevent the catharsis of spurious polyunsaturates.
St. Ival Gold, half the fat of any margarine. And it tastes smashing.
The original stuff finally reached our shores in 1991, and to advertise it, they decided to skip all the usual healthy living imagery in favour of outright silliness, hiring Luck and Floor and the Spitting Image team to create a nightmarish world of talking cows outraged at the product's existence, which made enough of a strange kind of intuitive sense to make up for not making any actual sense.
Is it on? Get on with it.
Right. Oh, I can't, I'm sure.
We want to complain about these adverts for...
I can't believe it's not butter.
They say it's made with buttermilk for a fresh butter-like taste.
Yeah, but they also say it's high in polyunsaturates, low in saturates, with virtually no cholesterol.
And does that sound like butter to you? Does it?
Can I do my song now?
I can't believe it's not butter. Can you?
It was one of the most popular and successful campaigns of the early 90s, winning awards, being reenacted in playgrounds, and sealing the stuff's place on British shelves for decades to come.
Oh, the other one! Now for tonight's star prize! The Moonfields, we ask you, is this butter?
We think it is butter.
Oh dear, well, it does look like butter now that it also comes in a block, but it's actually got less saturated fat than butter. Brian, tell them what it is.
I can't believe it's not butter. Can you?
No, Brian, I don't think they can, but that's the way it goes on.
Even as the campaign dragged on for almost a decade, eventually outliving Spitting Image itself, and became more and more confusing, irritating, and occasionally downright disturbing.
I haven't seen you here before.
I'm new to the area.
What do you think?
Lovely.
I see you're reading that shocking news about I can't believe it's not butter.
Yes.
Less than half the saturated fat of butter.
I'm made with buttermilk for that fresh butter-like taste. I don't like it.
I better know what you do like.
I can't believe it's not butter. Can you?
Seems like there's less of everything these days.
That's from 1998. There's a group of people out there right now in their early 30s with a cow fetish that they barely understand. If they could just get together, they could form the basis for a class action lawsuit against Unilever, Spitting Image, McCann Erickson, and quite possibly Jesus. The product's still going strong-ish in the UK, but has apparently been struggling of late. I can't think of any other reason why a couple of years ago Unilever changed the name to I Can't Believe It's So Good. A year later, they sold all their sammich-related brands to a new company, who promptly brought the name back.
They've reformulated I Can't Believe It's Not Butter with even more buttermilk.
So it tastes even more butter-like.
The cows are back, and this time, they're really rather miffed.
And if the consumers don't agree,
they get their money back.
Oh, money back, shmoney back, that's gonna work.
So have you got what it takes to buy some, while stocks last?
Well, look at that. I don't even have time to discuss Leslie Crowther asking dowdy housewives for the difference between stalk margarine and a dead crab. Although that Python reference pretty much covers it, really. Remember, butter is like a conch in the desert. Meditate on that one.
Let me put you in the picture, let me show you what I mean. The Messiah is my sister, ain't no king, man, she's my queen. Let me put you in the picture, let me show you what I mean. The Messiah is my sister, ain't no king, man, she's my queen. Let me put you in the picture, let me show you what I mean. The Messiah is my sister, ain't no king, man, she's my queen. Let me put you in the picture, let me show you what I mean. The Messiah is my sister, ain't no king, man, she's my queen.
You've been watching a Bob the Fish production. Thanks! If you haven't found it already, be sure to check out our website at bobthefish.org.uk. Literally hundreds of videos not unlike this one that will make you laugh, think and realise new things, or your money back. Which works out great because they're all absolutely free! All of this is possible thanks to the not unique way that Bob the Fish productions are paid for by you, the viewing public, via Patreon. For a donation of as little as £1 a month, not only do you ensure that I still have food and shelter so I can carry on making these programs, but you could become eligible for a whole host of cool extras. New video essays, special event live streams, all my content a week in advance, and my book on the history of the BBC, Rule the Waves, chapter by chapter as it's written. And some cake, if you go out and buy a cake and eat it while you're watching. And if you don't want to support on a monthly basis, you can make a one-off donation via Ko-fi. It all helps stave off scurvy. Bobthefish.org.uk. You make it what it is.